See, we ask this question because there are some people who really have a title pastor, and I think it, because they desire to be pastoring, but pastoring is not a title. Pastoring is a ministry, and a ministry one that is given by God, and so that is a birth, something that birthed within you. But a person can desire to be pastor, but they are really not a God called pastor. So there is a difference there. And I believe also that you can follow leadership, what they call leadership, and you eventually fall into pastoring. Like Joshua was Moses' minister. Moses' minister over 40 years. So leadership was sort of put on to him. So if a person follow leadership, good leadership, and that leader moved from the scene, that person can eventually have the mantle of pastoring. That's politically. We thank you for your testimony. Pastor Taylor, give us a little bio on your ministry and your calling.
God bless you, audience. God bless you, TV audience. It's an honor and privilege to be here tonight, as Bishop has said, this is Pastor Taylor. For me, I've grown up in church most of my life. I think when I was 14, I got saved. I was saved for like 2 years. But then in the church, people who say they were Christians were not living the lifestyle of a Christian. They were living one life in church, but outside they were living a different life. So I backslid. But when I got saved in 2001, I made up my mind that I am going to be an example of believers. One of the things that the church lacked when I came into the church was evangelism. Everybody was all about the church itself, but forget about those who were not saved. So I have a passion for souls. I have a passion to see the prostitute, the homosexual, the lesbians, the unreached reach with the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So for that, since I got saved 2001, my passion and my drive was to see hell empty and the church full, heaven full with believers. And then a year ago, I was called into pastoral ministry. I've been a minister for 7 years with Grace Temple. And then the Lord has led me to be a pastor for Kingdom Come Embassy Ministry International.
Okay. And how do you see this task as a pastor? You see it as an easy task?
Oh, wow. I can surely say, if I have not been called as a pastor, I wouldn't be taking this on. Because being a pastor is a tough job. But as Pastor Oswin says, you know, we need to be married to prayer. We need to be married to the word. I believe the reason why we have so many discouraged pastors today because they've lost their first love, which is prayer in their private time with their love of their soul.
Amen.
So I believe once we have prayer and the word, we are good. So it's hard, but we keep pressing because there are so many souls out there depending on us to finish the race and finish strong.
Amen. Jesus himself, the Bible says, he lifted up his eyes and saw the multitude as sheep without shepherd.
Yes.
He said to the disciples, look, the harvest is white, ready for harvest. The field is white, ready for harvest. Pray that the Lord of the harvest may send laborers in the vineyard.
Amen.
And so a pastor is one who to feed
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's a feeder.
Yes.
You need to have wisdom. You need to have the word and love.
Yes.
Wisdom, the word, and love.
Yes.
Wisdom to take care of the weak ones, the feeble ones. Because you have some people in church as sheep, which they are feeble, feeble-minded.
Yes.
And you have to have wisdom to keep those people.
Amen.
They like, they love to be seen, they love to be appreciated. Yeah, they have the love to be noticed, and you have to sometime give them that little pampering for the time being.
Yes.
Because you have lambs and you have sheep.
What?
Right?
Amen.
So a shepherd or a pastor is one who go before, not using a whip.
Amen.
Because you're not a driver, you're a leader.
Yes.
You is not a boss. You is a leader, so you have to lead by example. Pastoring is very nice if you are called to that office.
Mm-hmm.
It's like your married finger. See, this is the apostle,
mm-hmm.
and this one is the prophet, the pointer,
mm-hmm.
and the evangelist,
yeah.
the bigger.
Yeah.
But you have this married finger. You're married to those few members.
Amen. Amen.
And all when everybody leave and leave those three and four, you're still married to them.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
And it's not easy.
No, it's not.
If you don't get it, you can't take it.
My right. God. Exactly. Amen.
It comes also with a price.
Yes, yes, it does.
It comes with a price.
It's costly.
And you have to expect the unexpected. The person who tell you that they are watching your back.
Just the one of.
That's the first one leave you.
Amen. Amen.
You have to be aware of
Amen.
That.
Yes.
And I put no trust in nobody.
Yes.
But in the Lord.
Amen.
But in the Lord.
In the Lord, yes.
Time when pastoring become tough and rough, you have nobody to complain to but to the Lord.
Amen.
And you can't even let the saints know that you are crying. Don't cry to the Lord. I'm glad for this wonderful opportunity. And I believe it's one of the greatest honor to be a servant of God.
Amen. Amen.
The
Amen.
Greatest
that's,
honor
yeah,
in the human history is to call to be a servant of the Lord.
Amen.
When the Lord called me many years ago, I couldn't read. Could barely spell my name. But the Lord told me that he called me as a messenger. So that gave me hope that if I don't get it, I cannot give it.
Amen.
If I don't get a message, I cannot preach a message.
Amen.
So that built my faith that the Lord will tell me what to say.
Amen.
And even when Moses was fumbling,
he said,
the Lord said, I will touch your lips
yes.
and you will speak my words.
Amen.
And I can say that I am one whose lips have been touched
Hallelujah.
By the hands of God.
Hallelujah.
And when I were brought before ordination board in those days, or elders, they were not so learned, but they were well seasoned,
mm-hmm.
seasoned men and women. And I brought before this ordination board, and they said to me, Evangelist Rosemary, how do you know that you are called the ministry? And I feel something move within me. I said, by the inward move of God.
My God.
And everybody shout out, that's it, that's it, that's it. Inward move. Because I didn't have an answer. I did not have an answer. Is I had learned men stand before them.
Wow.
But the Holy Spirit moves within me.
I'm
given the utterance to say
yes.
by the inward move of God. That's
God.
Why I
yes.
know I'm called to
Amen.
The ministry.
Amen. Amen.
And from that day, I've been having that inward move from evangelist right up to pastoring over 57 years.
My
now.
God.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank God for the call, and I will not leave it the best is yet to come.
Amen. Amen.
Bless the Lord.
Amen.
Now, it is so much, I will say, many of us believe the scriptures and we want proof at all time what the scriptures say on this. Mm-hmm. But I discovered that the Spirit of God is speaking in these last days.
Yes.
That you can't even identify some of the things that is saying in the scripture right now. Because the Holy Spirit comes to continue the ministry that Jesus left.
Yes. Amen.
It says, when the Spirit of truth is come, he shall reveal things.
Yes.
He will continue.
Yes.
So the Spirit is revealing things. Mm-hmm. The scripture didn't tell us all in all details how to do this and how to do that and how to start the church.
No.
But if God had called you as a founder, a plant of a church, mm-hmm. he will give you the revelation,
yes.
how to set up that church.
Amen.
Yes, there are elders, there are apostles that can advise you, but he will give you your own vision,
yes.
for that work.
Yes.
And so make us be very sure,
yes.
that we are in our calling. Very imperative, know that we are abiding in our calling.
Amen.
Because that is where the anointing is going to flow,
yes.
in your calling.
Amen.
If you is a hand in the body of Christ, you're going to be anointed as a hand.
Yes.
Not as a foot.
No.
So if you want to be anointed as a foot, you're going to be a hand whole. You're going to be anointed as a hand. To lay hands on the sick.
Amen.
Bless the Lord. So I'm glad to have you here tonight, and we hope to do great exploiting together.
Yes. Amen.
In the kingdom of God. Now, I've been looking at a scripture where I think it's in St. John 15, and Jesus said, "You have not chosen me."
Yes, I have chosen.
But I have chosen you,
mm-hmm.
and ordained you that you may bring forth fruit,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and that your fruit remain.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, could you elaborate on that a little? That you may bring forth fruit. Now, what is the fruit of the called minister? What is the fruit? I heard one scripture said, Paul said to a certain young man, he said, "You are my first fruit."
Mm-hmm.
You are my first fruit. So souls, mm-hmm. are the fruit.
Yes.
That you may bring forth fruit, mm-hmm. and that your fruit remain.
Yes.
There are some folks bring forth fruit, but their fruit don't remain.
Mm-hmm.
They even die before spiritually, because you birth something out of your ministry. Somebody birth. That's the evidence that God has called you in that field,
mm-hmm.
to bring forth fruit.
Yes.
And the Apostle Paul himself said, "Ye are my epistle.
Mm.
Ye are my fruit. I don't want any more recommendation. Ye are my epistle. See and read of all men."
Yes.
You must bring forth fruit.
Yes.
One or two souls must be saved in your ministry,
yes.
or edified, marriage restored. Something must happen, yes. when you are called to ministry.
Amen.
And there I have seen people who, over the years, just taking other people's sheep.
Mm-hmm.
And they have nobody for themselves.
Mm.
Nobody for themselves. We have to make sure. Right? I love fishing. And sometimes I go by the beach and Some guys will give me some fish, but nothing sweet me like when I catch one fish
all
in my
right.
Myself.
Yes, yes. Wow.
When I throw my line and I feel the peak, and the line is blurring, I feel good that
yes.
bringing in a fish.
Yes.
And I'm not going to carry those fish and see if I catch them. I get me get them.
Right.
So we have to make sure that your birth, two important things, who birthed you and who grew you
mm-hmm.
in the ministry, who birthed you in the ministry and who grew you.
Yeah.
It has a lot to do with your entire life. Who birthed you and under whose ministry you grew and develop.
Nurtured.
Because if you even birth good
you have to be
and not grow good,
yes, right.
You're still handicapped.
Amen.
You have to grow good.
And that's the I think that's one of the most important part right now in ministry. There's so many ministries that's around, so many young, you know, ministers coming up have been nurtured.
Yes.
They've been hearing the pastors preaching and teaching them, but they're not properly nurtured. So when it's time for them to get into ministry for themselves, the fruit is not there.
Yes.
Because they weren't properly nurtured. It's like if you have a babe and baby's just born
mm-hmm.
and they're not nurtured on the mother's breast.
Yes.
Then that child's gonna be malnourished.
Yes.
But if they're properly nurtured on the mother's breast, then they're gonna be grown up.
Amen.
Turn to big men, young men and young women.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. So just like with the church, we have to be properly nurtured in the church. I just said we need a pastor, grow up in a pastor and nurtured by that same pastor.
Yes.
So that we can be fully equipped for the word that God has for us as ministers.
Good.
And also, I believe that even when you're called to be a pastor and you're walking in the office of a pastor, it does not stop there.
Mm-hmm.
You still need someone that is overseeing you,
yes.
that can correct you. If you don't have, as pastors, you don't necessarily have all the answers.
No.
You have the best of intention. You want to do the things that God has called you to do.
Yes.
And so you're giving out all the time. And because you're always giving out, you get depleted.
Yes.
So it's important that you're also covered by someone that you're held accountable to.
Yes.
That can judge that you are giving the right substance.
Amen.
Out to those that God has as ordained for you to shepherd.
Yes.
So someone has to be there to check you. When you're baking a cake, you can't pull it out of the oven until you test it and notice that nothing's coming out on the tester. Then you know that it is done. When you're in ministry, you still need to be replenished. So every now and then, you have a leader that comes in and pours into you.
Amen.
That covers you. And you can always go to when there's an issue. There's a problem, you're not standing in it by yourself.
Amen.
So you're not accountable to anybody.
Mm.
So when we talk about fruits, Bishop, fruits represent a lot of different things. There are
yes.
different kinds of fruits, just like there are apples, oranges, and guineps, and plums, and all of that stuff. We have different fruits in ministry as well. But the fruit that is more significant to Christ is that his people are set free, they are delivered.
Yes.
And they are walking uprightly in Christ, because the Bible talked about the shepherd, the sower who went out to sow seed, and some of the seed fell among thorns and they were choked up, but the ones that were in good ground, they received sustenance. I'm paraphrasing.
Yes, yes.
And so when you're in ministry, your fruit is by, you can look at somebody's life and you knew this person was wretched, you know this person was no good, but when you check them now a couple years later, you're not seeing the same person. Come on, there has been a metamorphosis that took place. There's
yeah.
been a transformation of that life. So that's like your stamp of approval that the Lord has given you
yes,
for that particular individual.
Amen. And it's not very much ministers will speak as all you speak. about trying to have a covering. Some just feel that they can do it on their own because they have an anointing on their life and things like that. But no, 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 no. You still need that covering. Even the Apostle Paul, about 20 times in the New Testament, he requests the covering of prayer from the saints.
Yes, yes, yes.
He said, pray for me.
Yes.
That I may be properly received.
Yes.
Because it's not all men are fit.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Them bad out there.
Yes.
So I need your covering of prayer.
Yes.
Amen. And one of the things that's missing, if you even now with our church, when we have prayer meetings, you only find a faithful few that will show up for prayer. On our prayer lines, a faithful few will show up for prayer. That's what's one of the things that's missing in the churches. It's amazing. The biggest church with 5,000 members call a prayer. I heard Darlene Bishop talking about her church. She called for prayer the first of the year, and only what 5% showed up for prayer. It's sad.
Yes,
And even as pastors, you know, we need more prayers than anything else.
Amen.
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. We need prayer because we are praying for the people. Mm-hmm. But who's praying for us?
All right.
We're covering the people.
Yes.
Who is covering
all
us?
All right.
You know, we are giving. We are always pouring out. Our lives are like poured out, as Paul said, for the people. But, you know, we need prayer, and that's important in the ministry and the churches. We need to mobilize a church to pray more. You know, to pray more, not only for the pastors, but for themselves and for the community.
Amen. Amen.
Prayer is essential.
Prayer is essential. Now, as a pastor, have you ever discovered in the ministry some unethical behavior of pastors?
Oh, yeah.
Could you share any, not in names, but share the kind of behavior that is among pastors, even in the spirit? Because I believe there are some craziness in the spirit. There are some bad manners in the spirit that people use in the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And when they finish, you know why I'm gonna come back.
Amen.
Why?
One thing that I've experienced, Bishop, even before I became a pastor, I had the prayer line before I actually was ordained as a pastor, and you would have pastors that comes on the prayer line, and they are the most unruly people on the prayer line. Mm-hmm. There's a particular way how you operate, but then they'll come and do whatever they want to do. You'll say, hoping up in prayer, and they'll prophesy, or they'll preach a message, and that's not the instruction that was given.
That's right.
If you are giving an instruction, say, we're giving you 2 minutes to say a word of prayer, that's what you're there to do. And if you are told to pray for pastors, then that's what you do. You pray, you follow the directives that were given to you. But you'll call them for 2 minutes, and they'll come and do 10 or an hour. And you'll try to nudge them to let them know we're on a time span. And because you are not a pastor, they feel like they can usurp authority over you. And so I've noticed that prior to becoming a pastor, and even becoming a pastor, one thing that I really find that is really sad in the body of Christ, there's so much competitiveness. Mm. You have pastors, instead of upholding you and strengthening you and encouraging you in ministry, you have pastors that goes out and sow discord to talk about you and talk bad about your ministry. Mm-hmm. Even if somebody is found in an error, you go to that person because, you know, there are people that are affected by whatever we do.
Yes.
So there are people, if somebody, when Abraham went to stand in the gap, he stood in the gap until he said, if there's 10, if there's this, when God's, mm-hmm. he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And so you always have to be concerned about the people. So you don't say things about the people. You have other pastors who blatantly stand on their pulpit and bad talk other pastors to their congregation.
Amen.
Where is that in God when the Bible says we are to love? Love covers. So even if I'm found in an error, it doesn't mean that you're condemning what I'm doing incorrectly, but you step to me to the side and you talk to me and say, this behavior is not right. You don't go to tell the world. After you have come to me, and if I didn't do anything, then you bring somebody else and you come to talk to me, and if I don't do anything, then you bring in front of the church. But the church has really gone into a bad state where we just talk real badly about people. Other pastors are a subject of your conversation and not the scripture. We preach about the pastors. We go on the pulpit. We're talking stuff. Just like Bishop said, if there's something that you have to share, he says doesn't call any names. You can say something without calling names or diverting the people's attention to whoever you're talking about, because people can't receive from somebody and they're still in office. So if you do that, you're sowing discord to the people.
Yes, unethical behavior.
Yes.
One of the another unethical behavior was even before I became a pastor, and even now in ministry, one of the things is that pastors, leaders on a whole, they live one thing and preach another. This bothers me. That's why I'm on my knees for the leaders. How can we preach to our members and to those in our congregation and tell them to do this, do that? We are a bunch of hypocrites in the pulpit.
Amen.
A bunch of hypocrites. And the Bible said judgment begins with the church, in the house of God. And I'm telling you, we see pastors dropping dead like flies. Sometimes we really wonder. I believe it's time that the pastors raise the standards of holiness, of righteousness, of godliness, starting in their lives be an open book, an example, so that the people in the pews can follow them, really follow them for their lifestyle. Let they be the epistle that all men can read.
Amen.
That's what I would love to see in the body of Christ with our leaders. Too long our leaders been living two lives. So many things going on behind doors. You know, we need leaders today, in today's generation, who is going to live what they preach. Not preach it, but not live it.
Amen. It is commonly in the unit church. But do you believe that God would use a person there to come on the platform and rebuke a pastor publicly?
Bishop, I believe that God is a God of order.
Yes.
I believe on occasions he will, because there's a scripture when David, I believe, slept with and the Lord sent the prophet to him. However, I believe before God does that, God is a God of a first, a second, and a lot of chances. And so God will speak to you as the leader. He'll let you know, son, daughter, you're in error. And he speaks to you over and over and over again, and you insist on not changing. Then of course he's going to bring you openly. Nathan did it.
Nathan went to him first and spoke to him by himself.
Right, so the Lord spoke to
him. So Nathan spoke to him by himself and gave him the parable.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then he said, oh, the man.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, he was still the king of Israel.
Yes.
Now, remember, he's still God's anointed.
Yes.
And so you have to remember and know, if God show you something as a discerner, is not for you to get up in the church and to rebuke the pastor.
Yes.
He can show you something,
yes,
but he didn't tell you to do that. Mm-hmm. You had to it. All right, we'll be right back on the hand. Ask Sister Blessing to give us a selection. Praise the Lord. We are talking about the unethical behavior of ministers in the body of Christ.
Amen. Well, good evening. Good evening, everyone. Good evening. This is Sister Blessing again. And it's another Saturday. Another Saturday. And we're just giving God the glory and asking God to give us direction to walk a straight way to glory.
Amen.
Let me see the hands if you believe Jesus is still in the main line. Keep them up. What by Christians can I make it in? No Wi-Fi Christians can I make it in? No Wi-Fi Christians can I make it in? No, no Wi-Fi Christians can I make it in? Listen, no Wi-Fi Christians can I make it in? No, 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 no Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. When you pay your praise bill, you have Holy Trinity. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No, 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 no Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. If you have four bars in the church and outside you lose signal, no Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No, 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 no Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. 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 Come again. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. God has a plan. It's a sacred connection. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No, 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 no Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. You can't log in on your parents' account. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No, 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 no Wi-Fi, no Wi-Fi can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No, 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 no Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. You can't log in on your parents' account. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi, no Wi-Fi can't make it in. You always buffering and searching. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can't make it in. No
Wi-Fi Christians can make it in. When you pay your praise bill, you have Holy Trinity. No! Wi-Fi Christians can make it in. No Wi-Fi Christians can make it in. God bless you.
No Wi-Fi Christian. If you only wait to come to church to have connection, use a Wi-Fi Christian. It's time to be connected at home, at the workplace, in your car. Amen. Otherwise, you cannot make it in. And you have some Wi-Fi pastors too. And Jesus said, many shall say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, have I not prophesied in your name? And in your name have done many wonderful works. But Jesus said, depart from me, I know you not. And Paul the apostle said, if I preach to others and don't keep my body under subjection, I will be a cast out. So any hour you're preaching upstairs and living downstairs, use a Wi-Fi Christian. God bless you, and we'll be back to our discussion, and there will be just a few moments on this, on ethical behavior of ministers. I believe that pastors are human beings, we make mistakes. But if a police officer makes mistake on his duty, it doesn't give the citizen any right to disrespect him. He can still lock you up. The authorities, the chief, will deal with him and maybe suspend him, but on duty is still your police officer, and you should respect authority. In the church, God has designated authority to the pastor of the house. She or he is in charge. Amen. God spoke man for the hour. Is or she is overseer over every other department in that unit church. And she is the head, or he is the head. Although Christ is the head of the spiritual body, then the pastor is the head of that local body. Amen. And she or he must be respected. And we cannot have the hand and the toe telling the head at all time what to do. You must hear from the head. You do make mistakes, and you can make suggestions, but that does not give you the authority to jump up in your face and do as you like and say as you like in the church that have a pastor. And again, some unethical preachers, when you, the first thing you do, especially you go to a new church, you have not spoken there before, is to find out how much time you have to play with.
That's right.
And if the pastor says, well, as the Lord leads, you still use your discretion.
That's true.
Otherwise, they're not going to call you up.
Amen. Yes, have to. Amen.
And it's always good to write back to that church.
Thank you.
And
thank,
thank them for having you speak, and if they could give you a letter of how well you did. We have that as orientation among our school. Get a letter how well you did, how long you stayed, and how well you did, so that you can have that letter put up recommending you for your first experience preaching at the church. And there are another thing about pastors and ministers of the gospel. Our ministerial ethics should teach us that there are certain things that done or said among pastors or about pastors that should not be said to your members.
Amen.
You should not bring that down to your members.
Amen.
And even when they bring that to you, you must have a way how to
deal with it.
Deal with that.
Paris of the beach. Paris of the breach.
Yes. And that is ministry.
Yes.
That is under the fivefold ministry.
Covering
under the fivefold ministry. Mm-hmm. It was a reason why when Jesus saw the disciples mending their net,
mm-hmm.
it gave him the revelation to know, because the net make it easier in the fishing industry
mm-hmm.
to catch more fish.
Yes,
they mend the net because it was broken.
Mm-hmm.
So the fivefold ministry is to strengthen, to mend
mm-hmm.
broken parts, to replace. And you can name others that the fivefold minister do, that you may grow up
yes.
and be strong. Perfect other ministry, not to kill other ministry, to perfect them. God bless you. I thank you for your input on this subject. Glad to have you. And we'll always come again and have some more important subject to deal with. An ethical behavior of ministry, of ministers in the spirit. They are doing it in the spirit. Disrespecting other pastors. Come on the platform and disrespecting them. And saying that the Lord said this, sometimes the Lord have not spoken. We have to be careful as ministers how we say the Lord said. You have to make sure
which God
that you get it right.
Yes.
Otherwise you have some havoc in the church of God. And I mean, one of the quickest ministry that Satan can enter into is the ministry of prophecy. He's quick to enter that, because everybody's a nice saint to say the Lord say. Mm-hmm. But it's not everybody is true.
Yes.
A lady's prophesying to the church sister and tell her that she should go back. The Lord said she should go back for her husband.
Mm-hmm.
And she went back for him. And he killed her. When he came. The husband killer will come. So I don't know what the Lord never said that. So we have to be careful, be 100% sure. We can prophesy and declare things. When you're under the anointing, you can declare things like that. Prophesy people life and declare things. And Job said, if you decree something, God will bring it to pass, establish it. So God bless you all, and if there's any question that you would like to ask before we close.
Well, Bishop, it is said that out of the mouth of two or three witnesses should the word be established. So
amen.
When someone brings a prophetic word, prophecy is in part, and a lot of times, depending with our flesh, our own spirit
yes.
speaks faster than the Holy Spirit, and
oh,
so we
right.
hear we hear what we want to hear, or we prophesy out of our own emotions
yes.
instead of letting the Holy Spirit speak, and that's when we're just too eager. There's too many egotistic.
Yes.
People that wants to be seen and don't realize that you're messing with people's life.
Yes.
Because even the Lord can give you a word in other instances that is fact. It's something that you really need, but it's not time. You're not ready
yes.
for that as yet.
Yes.
And so the Lord will show you something, and you have to ask God, what should I do with this information that you've given me? The Lord may want you to pray over it for a while. There's something with the individual that he wants you to take it on as a project and intercede for that person. Keep interceding, but instead we will give them a word. the Lord says. Before I became a pastor, I was told 11 years before I actually was ordained into the office a pastor. And I've heard it several times, over and over and over and over again. But there is a preparation stage.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are immature sometimes when it comes to prophecy. We're either immature, we're eager, or we just want to talk. We want to be seen. And so because of that, we mess up other people's lives.
Yes.
God does not make any mistake. God is not a God of error. God is all knowing. And true enough, God can give you a word. It's not that the prophetic is not authentic. It's authentic, but it has to be proven. It has to be tested by the word of God.
Amen.
And so that's why even before you begin to prophesy, you need to be prepared and trained, know how to speak. There are some things we speak out and we embarrass people.
Amen.
And God does not embarrass anybody. He gives you wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have to exercise wisdom when we prophesy.
Amen.
And that is so true, and that's why it's important. Like in a prophetic church, they're supposed to have order. Then, as Pastor Azulin said, by two or more words, two or more persons have to, when they say that word, it have to be
confirmed
by that person. So in a church where you have everybody, a prophetic church, it's supposed to have order. You know, when a word is given, it has to be affirmed by the head prophet.
Yeah, that's right.
So you can't just go and take it, Sister so-and-so say, God said, so I'm going to take it. And that's it. No, it has to be affirmed by the head prophet or the leader of the church. You can't just take whatever somebody said and run with it. That's why it's important to be trained and equipped in the prophetic before they can even prophesy.
Amen.
And Bishop, that's why ministry such as yours is very integral in times like this.
Mm.
The people need to be taught. The Bible tells us that because of lack of knowledge, the people perish. We perish because we don't know.
Amen.
When you don't know, you just don't know. And how can you know without a preacher?
Amen.
And how can he preach unless he be sent?
Amen.
And so when you're sent, God is not just going to set you up and just send you without preparing you. That there comes where we need accountability again. We need someone that we can be held accountable. You can even be operating in a church, but you can't be independent. You can do whatever you want. You hurt the people, whatever you want, and nobody can come in to correct you.
Amen.
You have to be held accountable to somebody.
Amen.
Amen.
I like the prophecy that was given to the Apostle Paul when he was moved by the Spirit to go to Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
He was prophesied to, not telling him the Lord said not to go,
mm-hmm.
but telling him what is going to happen to him.
My God, when he goes.
In these days, we'd have had to that.
Mm-hmm.
Since that is going to happen to you, well, it's a possibility that you should go.
Yes.
But Paul asked, did the Lord say I should not go?
Mm.
They said, no, but this is what's going to happen to you.
Yes.
The abundance
of
reflection of waiting you there.
Yeah.
Mm. He said, well, none of these things move me.
Mm-hmm.
I must finish my course with joy.
Amen. Amen.
So what God say, just say what God say, and what he didn't say, leave it alone.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
And wait for the confirmation.
Amen. All right, I think this is it for tonight, and we thank you all again for coming. And next week, I would like to see this panel come back, if it's possible. Next week.
We'll be happy to be here.
It was a privilege, Bishop.
Amen. So I'll give your name again, and where you have started your ministry, where you expect to have house your ministry, and so forth and so forth.
Again, I'm Pastor Oswaldine Facy. I'm the Senior Pastor of Worldwise Assemblies Ministries International. We're located at 1609 North State Road 7 in the McNabb 7 Plaza, North Lauderdale, Florida 33068. And our service begins at 11:30. We are there on Sundays at 11:30, on Tuesdays for prayer, and on Thursday we have Bible study. God bless you. It was indeed a pleasure. God bless you, everyone. I pray that you are blessed as a result of us being here on tonight to minister to your spirit. And I just pray that something that we have said will be a blessing to you.
Hey,
God bless you.
God bless you.
Yes, and it's a privilege to be here. This is Pastor Georgia Taylor, Senior Pastor of Kingdom Come Embassy Ministry International. We are located in Sunrise, 4505 Northwest 103rd Street. That's Sunrise. Zip code is 33351. You can reach us at 754-422-2285. We meet at 11:30 on Sunday mornings, and 7:30 on Thursday evenings for the gathering. That's prayer and Bible studies. Once again, it's an honor to be here. I just want to say, if you're watching this broadcast and you're not saved, I'm just going to encourage you right now to give your life to the Lord. Just accept and acknowledge that you're a sinner. And just believe that Jesus Christ died for your sin, that he loved you so much, he wished that you did not perish, but have eternal life. And just come, confess your sins, and just place your life in his hand. Call upon him right now and say, Lord, be master of my life, and you shall be saved.
Praise the Lord. Thank you all for coming. This is Bishop Rose Green, the Chancellor and Founder of the Land Planting Institute, who specializes in corresponding courses from diploma up to doctorate. If you're interested, you can call me at 954-642-6966. The Lord bless you. Until next week, same place, same time.
God bless you.
God.
Praise God.
Amen.
Let us pray. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's bow as we enter in. Father, we honor you tonight.
Yes.
We give you the praise, we give you the
glory.
We honor you tonight because you are a good God.
Yes.
You are great and you are greatly to be praised.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you, God, for this privilege where we can come boldly to you again, Lord, knowing
yes.
that you
yes.
are in the midst of us. Lord, we thank you now
thank
for
you.
Touching our hearts, our minds, our spirit,
oh,
our
yes.
emotions,
oh,
Lord. God, we thank you for touching. Touching somebody tonight
yes.
at their point of need. Lord, we pray in the name
yes.
of Jesus
yes.
that you'll heal somebody tonight, deliver somebody
oh,
tonight,
yes.
save
yes.
somebody
yes.
tonight.
Yes.
God,
yes.
when it's all said and done, Lord, we need you to be glorified.
Yes.
God, as we spoke tonight about the unethical attitudes and behavior of your leaders, Lord, we
yes.
lift
Lord.
Up your leaders before you. Tonight,
yes,
and we
Lord.
Pray, God, that you'll begin to wash, that you'll begin to cleanse, that you'll
yes,
begin to
yes,
set them
Lord,
apart
yes,
again.
Yes,
my God, we pray for a complete avakoshata deliverance,
yes, Lord,
even
yes,
in your leaders, Lord. God, your word says that if you smite the shepherd, the sheep will scatter.
Oh,
and
God.
So we pray now that the people of God will have godly leaders,
yes,
leaders
Lord,
after
yes.
your own heart who will not scatter the sheep, Lord.
Yes.
Leaders that will tend and nurture and love them like
oh,
you love them,
right.
Father.
Hallelujah.
We thank you tonight, God, even for what you're doing.
Oh,
indeed, that you'll
yes,
keep
Lord,
us,
yes.
Lord God, in your perfect peace.
Yes.
Keep us in your will, Lord. Deliver us from all evil, we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. And amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
God bless you.
Glory to God.
May the Lord bless us and keep us. Amen.
Cause
his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May he lift up his countenance upon us and give us peace for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
God bless you.
bless you.